praise God for all this wonderful weather and wonderful sunset. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And we're all still here. Hearts are still beating. Here to enjoy a day in Florida. Oh, but I tell you, we're here for a purpose on this earth. Oh, Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 says, the death and life is in the power of the tongue, and those who love it shall eat the fruit of it. This is the word of God. This is the truth. God is a spirit, the Bible says, but God became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. That's Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came as the only begotten of the Father. And Jesus said that whoever believes in me does not believe in me, but in him who sent me, in John chapter 12. He said, whoever sees me sees him who sent me. He said, I have come as a light into the world that you should no longer abide in darkness, whoever believes in me. You know, that's the problem, is most people, even on this beach, most people in this world are not believing in Jesus because they're abiding in darkness. Lest Jesus be a liar. And I think we can all agree that Jesus is not a liar. God does not lie like men lie. But Jesus told the truth. And Jesus said, if I tell you the truth in John 8, why do you not believe me? Jesus said. Because he said that whoever hears God's words is of God. But he says, you do not hear because you are not of God. John 8, verse 47. And I'm concerned for your soul today, because most of you people are on the way to hell. Most of you people are rejecting the plan of God's salvation for your life. Oh, Psalm 68 says, oh, our God is the God of salvation. And to God the Lord belongs escapes from death. But God will wound the heads of his enemies, the hairy crowns of those who still go on in their sins, the psalm says. If you're going on in your sins, God is declaring you his enemy. God is saying he's going to wound your head, your hairy scalp, the enemy of God. No, now's your time. You need to repent. Quit believing the lies in your church. Quit believing the false doctrines of the Catholic Church. Quit believing the false doctrines of all the denominationalism out there in the world. Instead of believing the Word of God. Instead of believing the Spirit of God. Look, the Scripture says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, it says to reject every doctrine that does not accord with godliness. Look, that's the only thing that's going to matter on the day of judgment. Are you as he is in this world? Or are you following the fashions of this world that are perishing and falling away and going to fall off into eternity without God? Oh, the Scripture says in 2 Peter chapter 1, he said, according to his divine power, we've been given all things pertaining to life and godliness by him who called us through glory and virtue in his knowledge, that we have received exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these we are partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the world through lust, Peter said. Peter said, look, there's a divine power. There's knowledge of the Holy One. There's promises. And through these you escape the corruption that is in this world through lust. You don't go deeper into it. You don't continue on in sin. You don't continue following the ways of this world, being the enemy of God, the Scripture says. I'm terrified for my neighbor today. Friendship with the world is enmity with God, James said. He said that why do you make yourself a friend of the world, you make yourself the enemy of God. James 4 verse 4 says. Oh, but Psalms chapter 1 says, blessed is the man, blessed is the woman, who takes not counsel from the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in it he meditates day and night. He'll be like a tree planted by the waters, and he'll yield his fruit in due season, and his leaf will not wither. Oh, and he'll be blessed in all that he does. But the ungodly are not so, the psalm says. They are like the chaff that is blown away. Therefore, the ungodly will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. The way of the ungodly is going to perish. What's going to happen to you if you live ungodly? You're going to perish as well. You're going to fall off into eternity without God in hell. But God stretches his hand out to you as mercy, the true mercy of God. Not this false gospel that's being preached today from most pulpits. Ear-tickling message that tries to gain all the popularity to the preacher and to the ministry. It's all about the building. It's all about the mission of the church. It's not about the mission of God. God's mission for you is that you would die to yourself, that you would be united in the sufferings of Christ. Because Paul said, he said, I might know the suffering of his and be joined into his death, that I by some means attain to the resurrection from the dead. Right now you're dead. Right now in your sin, you're being destroyed. You're being pushed away and chased away by your sins. Because evil pursues sinners, the Bible says. But to the righteous, good will be repaid, the proverb says. No, you can't change God's law. God doesn't change. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Oh, we tell you, you must be born again, the scripture says. I tell you, better find out what this means to be born again and be seeking God diligently. In these last days, with all the deception, don't think you can be a Christian and spend your time indulging in TV and indulging in worldly entertainment and indulging in alcohol. Don't think you can be a Christian and do those things. The Bible says in Titus chapter 1, verse 16, many profess to know God, but by their works they're denying Him. They being abominable and disobedient and to every good work disqualified, Titus said, by the Holy Spirit. I don't want you to be disqualified. I want you to make it to the end. God is gracious, yes. God can cover over your sin, yes. But He's telling you to go and sin no more. Can't you do it? Don't you have a vision in your life? The Bible says in Proverbs 28, verse 19, it says, without a vision, the people perish. My people perish for lack of knowledge. You got to have a vision of the Holy One of Israel touching you, forgiving you, changing you. He changed me. He forgave me, cleansed me. He commanded me to do the work. Oh, the Bible says, cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Turn your laughter into gloom and your joy into heaviness, and humble yourself before the mighty hand of God. It's not the way of this world. The way of this world is just do whatever feels good. Go and get yours. Go and live in sin and pray a prayer and think you're going to make it to heaven someday. That's not the gospel. That's not what the Bible says. No, the Bible says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all the filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Do you notice that scripture? It says to cleanse ourselves from the filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit. That means you put away from you all your alcoholism, all your ego, all your worldly ways, your love of money, your pride, your sexual immorality, your acceptance of abortion and homosexual marriage and all the things in this world that go against God's word. And the Bible says to receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your soul. I'm not able to save your soul. I'm a messenger of God. God sent me here. God bless you too. I'm just a messenger. I believe the word of God, and God put His spirit in me through His grace. And you know, I'm just here to tell you that I know the word of God's going to endure forever. I know that God's going to have His way in the whirlwind. He's going to chase His enemies away in 1 hour. He's going to come with calamity on this world suddenly. And what's going to happen to you if you reject God's word now? You know, Jesus told a parable in Luke 19. He said, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a landowner who went away into a far country to receive a kingdom, and he left his goods to be taken care of by his stewards. Oh, but the stewards said, they said, we will not have this man to rule over us. They sent a delegation against this man. They sent a delegation against Jesus. But then Jesus came back having received the kingdom. And he said, bring to me those servants and settle accounts with me, with them. And then he came, and some took the talents and increased and received more. And he said, oh, well done, that good and faithful servant. You were faithful with a few things. Be ruler over many things. Give them 10 cities. Give that one 5 cities. But then there was one servant who took his master's good and he hid it in the ground. And what did the master do to that servant? He said, oh, you wicked and lazy servant. Bring those to me, my enemies of mine, Jesus said, and slay them before me. These people did not want me to rule over them. You see, you're in a time right now where the choice is now. You can let Jesus rule, be the ruler of your life, be the Lord of your life, or you can choose to be the ruler of your own life and follow your own way and follow the ways of the god of this world, Satan. It says in 2 Corinthians 4, it says that Satan has blinded the eyes of the unbelievers, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. For God has commanded a light to shine out of the darkness, and has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ, the scripture says. in the face of Jesus. There's no other face. There's no other name that by which men can be saved. You can believe that people can believe what they want and make it to heaven. You can believe that there's many paths to God, but Jesus has commanded and shown you that there is no other name. There is no other path. Oh, and if you don't stand for the one and only Savior, then you're the enemy. You're the one who's on the broad road. The Bible says that broad is the road that leads to destruction, Jesus said in Matthew 7. Many are on that path. The majority of people are not going to be saved. Where are you at? Are you on the narrow path? I'm seriously concerned for my neighbor. I'm seriously aching in my heart because I know most of you are on the broad path in this country, in this land of deception, this land of deceitfulness. You know, the scripture says in Psalms 5, it says, "Hear, give ear, O Lord, to the words of my mouth. Consider my meditation." Oh, but America's not blessing God is the problem. You can bless America all you want. God has blessed America, but America's not blessing God. So now God's bringing a curse upon this country. And you don't see it because maybe you're blinded. Maybe you think that you know, the Bible says that because a sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, it says, therefore, the hearts of men is fully set in them to do evil. Ecclesiastes 8:11. Because God's judgment isn't broken out yet, you think God is in favor of this country. You're mistaking God's patient, long-suffering, trying to give this people in this country time to repent for God's acceptance of the wicked deeds of this land. And you're deceived along with the country. Oh, the Bible says that people suppress the truth in their unrighteousness.
People are here to witness the beauty.
If you want to talk to somebody.
No.
Don't touch my stuff, man. I got you on video here.
Sunset, you know, and the sunset, you know, and the silence.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to keep preaching because you're trying to stop the preacher.
No.
Yeah.
I love preaching.
No, if you love preaching.
Evangelist.
No, you're a hypocrite.
No,
you're drinking alcohol and smell it on your breath. Yes, you are. How much have you had to drink?
I am not a hypocrite.
How much have you had to drink?
It doesn't matter.
You're slurring your speech? It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
What about 1 Corinthians 6? No drunkards, you don't inherit the kingdom of God. That's a hypocrite. The hypocrites in heart store up wrath.
Absolutely.
You say you agree with God's word, you don't want to preach?
I love preaching. I love evangelizing.
God said to go and save the lost. Where's the right place when Jesus said to preach the gospel to every creature? Who's every creature?
It is every creature.
The earth is the fullness. And
I agree.
Look, you're drinking out here, man. What are you doing drinking out here? So you can drink and get drunk? You can get drunk and be inebriated. I'm concerned for you. You're in greater danger. I'm going to keep preaching. We want to talk to them. The Bible says it would be better for you not to know the way of righteousness than to turn from that holy commandment which was delivered to you. It's like a dog returning to their vomit. You can tell me not to preach to these lost souls out here and tell me you're an evangelist yourself. Well, there you go. You got a cursing out of your heart. The Bible says out of the fullness of the heart, out of the abundance of the heart, so the mouth speaks. I speak blessings to you. I speak the gospel. Yeah, you're ruining God's earth with your sin. You're ruining God's creation. You're a partaker of wickedness. I'm a partaker of the answer. I'm a partaker of the answer. The Bible says that he who does deceptive work, it says, sows deceitfully, but he who sows righteousness will have a sure reward. I sow righteousness into your life. I have a sure reward. You sow for yourself deception. You sow for yourself deceit, wickedness, agreeing with the world, trying to stop the preaching. You know, why don't you have a little self-sacrifice in your heart? Maybe you say you know God, but then you disagree with the preaching. You're probably the one that needs the preaching the most. You know, because the Bible says, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. And the leaven of the Pharisees is hypocrisy. You can say you're a Christian. You can say you love God just because you're born in America. But the Bible says that God's able to raise up children from the stones. It said, John the Baptist, he said, therefore bear fruit worthy of repentance. There's no fruit of repentance. There's no evidence of your faith. You have a dead faith out here. The Bible says faith without works is dead. It says a man is not justified by faith alone. A man is justified by works as well. Works of righteousness. Not works of the flesh, not works of the law. Paul taught against those things. But he said that your faith is validated. The Spirit validates your faith. Don't think you're okay with God because you went to church on Sunday or you prayed a prayer at youth group. God sends us out here to correct you. The Bible says, better are the wounds of a friend than the kisses of an enemy, Proverbs 27:5. Better to hear the rebuke of the wise than the song of fools over there in the square, Ecclesiastes 7. Oh, it says, the wise in heart, they store up commands. He who receives instruction is in the way of life, but he who refuses correction is stupid. The scripture says, No, I come out here because I care for you. And I'm like Paul. Paul said, open your hearts to us. For we have been given to you to die with you and live with you together. We have wronged no one. We have cheated no one. We have corrupted no one. Oh, great was my boldness of speech towards you. Great was my confidence towards you and my rejoicing in all my tribulation, Paul said. For our body was given over to death. Yes, trouble was on every side, but God, who comforts the downcast, comforted us, he said in 2 Corinthians 7. Therefore, he said, observe this very thing. He said that the gospel that was preached to you, of what manner that it was preached, it said, that it produced in you diligence. What clearing of yourselves. What indignation, what fear, what zeal, what vindication. He said that you prove yourself clear in this matter. When the gospel is preached to you, it produces in you a heart that burns towards God, diligence towards God. You start to say, man, I need to seek God now. I'm not promised tomorrow. God's been patient with me and forgiving towards me. I deserve hell. That, you know, your sin is grave in the sight of a holy God. You don't understand. Your alcohol abuse, your denial of God's word is grave towards God. It's not a light thing that God has held back his judgment from you. Oh, the scripture says that God did not spare the angels who sinned, but he cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved for the day of judgment. And he did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. He said, but he also turned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them to destruction, to be an example to those who afterwards would live ungodly. For there was a righteous man named Lot in those cities. He was oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked. And that righteous man dwelling among them, it tormented his righteous soul, seeing and hearing their lawless deeds. Then God knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment, especially those who walk according to the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise authority. These are presumptuous, self-willed. They're not afraid to speak evil of dignitaries, whereas angels who are greater in power do not dare bring a reviling accusation against them to the Lord, Peter said. So they're like natural brute beasts meant to be caught and destroyed. It says that they count it pleasure to carouse in the daytime. Their spots and blemishes, carousing in their own deceptions while they feast with you, having eyes full of adultery and cannot cease from sin. They are unstable. Enticing unstable souls. They have a heart trained in covetous practices, and they are accursed children. God's going to accurse you if you continue on in your sin, living like a natural brute beast, following pornography, following drug use, alcohol abuse, following all the things, all the wicked things of the flesh. Yes, it's going to be terrifying when you wake up on the other side of eternity and you face him who is pure, who is holy, who is righteous. Oh, the scripture says the righteousness of the blameless directs his way aright, but the wicked falls by his own wickedness. No, don't fall by your own wickedness. You need to turn from your wicked ways. Turn from the cursings of your heart, all the vileness in your heart, all the things you say and all the things you do that are evil. Yes, that's you. That's you. You need to turn from your sin. If you don't repent, Jesus said you're going to perish. No, there's no hope for you unless you repent and turn and believe and follow Jesus. You got to follow Jesus Christ, serve him. The Bible says, serve the Lord with fear, rejoice with trembling. Oh, because the judgment's going to come. Oh, but Jesus Christ, his mercy endures forever. God's mercy is higher than the heavens. His righteousness reaches to the clouds. He gives righteousness. He gives wisdom. He gives what is good. He imputes righteousness to us, forgives our sins. But you have to turn. You got to seek him. You got to receive from him. Open your heart to God. There's only one thing that needs to be said, and that's God's word. It's the only thing worthy of speech is the knowledge of God. Because the Bible says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. I speak as God's oracles. I tell you that Jesus Christ, he's going to come on the clouds from heaven. He's going to come at the voice of an archangel. Skies are going to part, and you're going to see him return from heaven. And the Bible says if you're raised with Christ, you need to seek those things which are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Don't look to the things. The Bible says, set your affections on the things above, not on the things of the earth, for you died. And your life is hidden in Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, you will appear with him in glory. Don't you want to appear in glory? Don't you want to have your life hidden away in Christ? There's only one other option for you today. The only other option is for you to be apart from Jesus and to fade away into eternity without him. You know, there's no middle ground with the scriptures. Jesus said, whoever doesn't gather with me scatters abroad. Oh, he said, you're either with me or against me. A man cannot serve two masters. He's going to love the one and he's going to hate the other.